All right, so with that, let's jump in. It's my great pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker, someone I've known pretty much my whole life. So ladies and gentlemen, I bring you Peter Horst. Thank you. That's just too kind. So we are here to talk about marketing in the Trump era. And I almost feel as though I have to apologize in that we're in this world where you pretty much can't escape the world of politics, right? No matter where you are on the political spectrum, you're probably torn by two feelings. One is, oh my God, I'm so sick of hearing about it. And on the other hand, what's new? What's the latest? What's happening, right? So it's almost like this car wreck on the side of the road that you can't stop looking at, and it's inescapable. And yet here I am bringing it back in the morning first thing. But this is not a political talk. This is not even really a talk about Trump per se. And in fact, at the end of this talk, you should probably have no idea where I stand, because that's not the point. We can talk about that over a beer. But what we're here to talk about is the environment for brands and for marketing, and what has changed, and what new challenges does that bring, and how do people who work in the consumer and the branding arena deal with all of that. So you heard a word about me. I've worked a bunch of different places, B2B, B2C, product, service, technology, and now I'm in sort of my recovering CMO phase and hanging out a shingle as CMO Inc. and doing consulting and writing and speaking and really kind of enjoying Career 2.0. So if you're interested in anything that I have to say here, follow me at these places, and I do a lot of writing on this kind of stuff. So that's me. Let's talk about the new world. And you know, the truth is the world did change on November 6th. It changed for the world, for the country, for politics, for society, in ways that we probably won't fully appreciate for some time. But the fact is that the world changed for brands and for marketing as well. And the reality is that this isn't driven by Trump. This isn't all about Trump. There were a number of really very seismic trends and changes that were already underway that were a part and parcel of what we're looking at right now. And really, at a macro level, it's about the middle collapsing and giving away, and across so many different spectrums, just falling into this divided, polarized environment. And as we've seen, any business, retailer perhaps, who was really focused on that big, solid middle, found themselves struggling as the world kind of divided. So one way in which this polarization happened, of course, was in the world of news and information, right, where we just got this radical polarization, which then fed our already sort of in-place confirmation bias, where we just continued to believe what we believe even more fervently. And, you know, we learned all kinds of new terms like fake news and alternative facts, all sort of catalyzed by this general decline of civility. So the temperature's going up, the polarization's going up, the digging into positions are happening as the world is sort of dividing. Along with this, some really kind of alarming trends in terms of trust and how people look at the institutions that really dominate life. And this is the Edelman Trust Barometer. And they found that pretty much across the board, last year, trust levels in institutions of pretty much every kind were at near historic lows. Trust in government, corporations, politicians, CEOs, NGOs, all at just rock bottom levels. And interestingly, there were some other really sort of striking findings. One was what they call the trust gap between what they describe as the informed public, who consume a lot of information, read newspapers, more educated, and those less so. And a 21-point gap, those who are less informed, much more sort of distrustful of the world in general, government, corporations, et cetera. There's also a fear gap, and they found a 22-point gap between those who voted for Trump and voted for Clinton. So just another sign of this sort of really stretching of the poles of just sort of how people think, how they feel, how they look at the world. And you know, one of the most disappointing in all these is only 37% trust CEOs to do what's right. Right? So they just look at the world around them and think, it's not working, they don't have my back, I don't trust them, this just kind of sucks. So it's not really surprising that as we kind of take a step back and look in the world of brands and consumer products, that we see this incredible growth in the craft brands. And these craft brands are characterized by the sense of authenticity and genuineness and a sense of place or a sense of person in the form of the founder and this sort of warm-blooded, three-dimensional reality that people can relate to and thereby sort of trust and feel good about, as opposed to these sort of, you know, semi-evil, faceless, bloodless corporations. So we're looking at a new reality, right? We have to really accept that the rules have changed and we're dealing with a set of dynamics that are really quite meaningfully different than what we used to. So at the highest level, I say that brands are facing more risks from more sources that have greater virality than ever before, right? These are issues that can come out of the blue and swamp your boat while you're not even looking. And all you have to do is ask some of these brands who have experienced this buzzsaw. And by the way, this buzzsaw cuts in both directions. You know, if you're perceived as being favorable to Trump or the administration or some of the issues that they support, you get in some big trouble. If you're seen as contrary to those things, you're also seen in big trouble, whether or not you really intended to be on one side or the other. And lest you think that this is a big global brand issue, I'll talk a little bit about the cute little Finch sewing store in cute little Lynchburg, Virginia, that also got caught up in this buzzsaw. So it's an issue that affects pretty much everyone. So what are some of these new realities? Well, we're facing a bifurcated market along so many different ways, right? Urban, rural, upmarket, Main Street, more educated, less educated, Democratic, Republican, right? Just sort of split down the middle in so many ways. And what this does is it creates a really challenging environment for brands and retailers, anyone who thrives on sort of broad reach mass messaging. Because there's an excellent chance that if you do anything that has any substance, anything that's beyond just a simple functional product demo, you face a really decent chance of offending somebody. So here Starbucks does what might sort of generically be considered a good for the community thing, talking about hiring 10,000 refugees, and that creates an incredible backlash, boycotts, right? People with pitchforks and torches outside the Starbucks stores. So mass messaging becomes a real challenge. And what we're really seeing here is kind of a squeeze where, somewhat paradoxically, even as consumers are saying, I don't trust you, big corporation, but guess what? The world's broken. I don't think government's going to do anything. So I'm looking to you to make something happen. You've got to be part of the solution, even though I'm not too thrilled with how you've done so far. So there's this expectation that these big brands will take a stand, will have a voice, will have a point of view on some of these critical issues of the day, which creates a bit of a squeeze, right? It creates a situation where it's tough to kind of float in that happy middle once again, where you're either becoming sort of a tribal leader around an issue or a point of view or a set of values, or you're saying, hey, I make canned peas, right? I don't have any point of view. There's no reason why canned peas should be taking some social, political, moral stand. And you're relatively more in the commodity space. And there's no free lunch. There's risk either ways. If you're taking a stance as a tribal leader, once again, you're going to very clearly alienate and offend people who are not a part of that tribe. Whereas if you say, hey, I'm canned peas, then you risk becoming a less resonant, less relevant commodity that's more easily traded out and doesn't have that sort of bond in a meaningful way with the consumer. So no easy position there. And I think to illustrate that, you may remember a Cadillac ad from, I believe it was the Oscars, that I think tried to sort of deal with this in their own way, and let's take a look.
We are a nation divided. That's what they tell us, right? This chasm between us. But what they don't tell you, what doesn't make the news, is this. We carry each other forward. No matter who we are, or what we believe, or where we come from, we've had the privilege to carry a century of humanity. Lovers, fighters, leaders. But maybe what we carry isn't just people. It's an idea that while we're not the same, we can be one. And all it takes is the willingness to dare.
So, beautiful film, stirring, right? What's not to love about a little girl hugging her, you know, military dad? But at the same time, I don't think this gets done what they probably hoped. Because it sort of sidles up next to the issue of, hey, there's tension and stress out there, but gosh, it's really kind of cool. Let's just sort of get along. Thank you, Cadillac. And, you know, a couple of issues there. One is there's not really a point of view there. There's sort of a vagueness of it's kind of bad, but geez, it's really kind of sort of good. And then there's this brought to you by Cadillac. And I'm not sure there's an authentic history there of Cadillac as the uniter of society. It was an interesting, you know, move. We saw a woman, an African-American, and an old guy, but they were all pretty rich, famous people. So there was sort of a credibility gap there in my mind. So I think this illustrates the trickiness, the challenge of how do you stake out something that feels like a safe middle ground in this environment. Another new reality, and to a certain extent this has always been true, but I believe it's more true than ever before, where you will be scrutinized, judged, and frankly, you know, this is not really America, you'll be presumed guilty. There will be this just natural assumption that if it's not totally obvious what you meant and what you did, then I will make an assumption that there was something nefarious or sort of amoral in what you did. And this just becomes this sort of relentless scrutiny that every brand, every retailer has to live with. And a great example is Budweiser with their Super Bowl ad. Now, here they are having flesh ripped out of their sides by all these craft brands that we talked about with their cool founder stories and, you know, their groovy vibe. And they say, wait a second, we've got a founder. We've got a really awesome founder story. This young guy comes to America with a vision and builds a great brand. Let's go tell our founder story. So as you know, Super Bowl ads, you spend practically a year working on those things. They're coming to completion. Along comes the travel ban. Few short weeks before they run this ad, and suddenly they're viewed as railing against the administration's position on immigration. And I sat and talked with the president of the agency. That was not the agenda. It started long before there was such a thing as President Trump. But somehow, you know, they were viewed as you're the guys trying to, you know, slam the president and slam this thing, and suddenly there's boycott Budweiser, and once again, the villagers with the pitchforks and the torches. There's a particular risk when consumers are filling in a vacuum that is the page called your values, right? Where they don't know what you stand for, they don't know what kind of a person you are, they will make assumptions generally to the negative. And, you know, poor Uber, poster child for so many things. But in this particular case, they're the poster child for not having invested in telling people who they are and what they stand for. Now, perhaps in retrospect, that was a good thing. But in this particular case, I do think there was no malice, no ill will, no bad intent. There they are, there's a taxi strike at JFK Airport, and they say, wow, we don't want to be perceived as profiting from a taxi strike, so let's turn off the old surge pricing switch. And then a few hours later, they had to say, wait, you know, we turned it off. It's not about, you know, sort of breaking the strike or anything, no bad intent there, we just didn't want it, you know, it's okay. It was just a few short hours later, if you see the timestamps there. But that wasn't quick enough, that wasn't enough to counteract what followed, which was the tide of boycott Uber, massive protest, look what you're doing. So it becomes this sort of risk of being the empty vessel. And this issue with Uber illustrates a broader new reality, which is that consumers are increasingly looking at brands as an outlet for action and expression in a world where they feel powerless and unheard. So they're sitting there saying, the world's broken, I don't trust anybody, I sure don't think government's gonna fix it, I hope corporations do, but I'm not gonna bet my house on it. Nobody cares what I think, I'm powerless, but by God, I can delete your app, right? Or I can stop drinking your coffee, or I can declare I'm not buying your beer. And there's a little bit of a, you know, instant gratification sugar high that comes with that. You know, it wasn't really the hard work of social change. And it's a way of taking action in a world where people just kind of don't know what to do. So suddenly, you see these boycotts, you see these delete the apps, and consumers up in arms, villagers with pitchforks. And I believe that this is really transforming what has been a traditional paradigm in terms of corporate reputation. Now, I would say that people who are corporate reputation experts would tend to disagree with me, but luckily for you, I'm right and they're wrong. So here's the deal. Traditional thinking said that corporate reputation and brand health are two entirely separate things that really don't affect one another. So for example, you can read in the newspaper that, you know, Global Bank A is under investigation for some violation of a money laundering statute and the CEO's in trouble. And you sort of say, corporate shenanigans, my checking account is fine. But that it's not until you read Global Bank is cheating its customers and jacking fees without them knowing about it, that you say, wait a second, this now affects me personally. So that's the only point at which they would say corporate reputation starts to bleed into brand health. I think this dynamic that I've been talking about, where consumers are frustrated and looking to brands as ways to morally badge themselves and ways to take action in a broken world, is changing this paradigm. And how you feel about the corporation, how you feel about the CEO, what you know about the way they operate in the world, actually does meaningfully affect how you think about their product, their service, their consumer, customer-facing value proposition in ways that can really affect choice and sales, retention. So, all of these new rules calling for new moves, what do we do about it? So working with a research firm that I've worked with for decades, we put together this sort of framework that we're calling the brand resiliency model, which is sort of, you know, a way to think about how do you issue-proof, crisis-proof your brand in a world where you're just surrounded by these risks that can come flying out at you at a moment's notice. And it sort of starts with finding your core, then digging deep and understanding your constituents, creating the scenarios that you might be facing, practicing proactive, ongoing transparency, and then executing bravely when the time comes. And I'll step through each of these. So the first is finding your core, right? What's really at the heart, the soul, the center of your brand? And this is really about going beyond, you know, the mission statement, right? Pretty much every company has what is, let's face it, a mostly sort of bland, you know, we're here to provide healthful snacks for people everywhere, every day. You know, something that just kind of fills in the blanks, feels good, but doesn't really say a whole lot. Now, organizations that have invested the energy in something that's really sharp and really powerful, that's quite catalyzing. I've done that, lived through it, and seen the effect it can have. But for the most part, you know, we don't really have that statement on the wall that is that powerful call to arms. So it's really about digging deep on really why are we here and what are we doing? Why is the world a better place that we're here? And what are the things we care about that go beyond the canned peas we manufacture every day? And a few things are really important here. You know, one is being true to your DNA. And as you think about these issues and what, if any, issues do you want to sort of identify with, that they are authentic and genuine and relate to who you are and where you've been. So that means no bandwagon hopping. That means no sort of plucking an issue from, you know, the headlines and saying, hey, that'd be really cool. We could get some volume with this group if we said, you know, look at us. We're all about whatever issue of the day. So it's about really sort of finding that center. And having done that, very critically, align with your board, align with leadership, and make sure everyone is on the same page. Because as we talked about earlier, any choice, whether it's a choice to stand for something or stay out of the fray, right? Both of those are decisions, and they both come with risks and consequences. And you don't want to be in the heat of the moment suddenly pointing fingers and saying, well, wait, why did you, I didn't, who said we cared about, right? Or who said we didn't care about this issue? And, you know, there was an episode, company down the street, Target, where announcement was made about their bathroom policy in North Carolina, which was an inclusive, use the bathroom that you're comfortable with. By the way, a policy that most of the large retailers had, but Target was the one that made a public statement about it. Caused a great deal of uproar and controversy and boycotts, pitchforks. And in retrospect, Target has said they think that caused billions of dollars in lost sales because they were already facing sort of a challenging environment in that marketplace. And there's a perspective that said that one issue was just enough to push them past a tipping point for many, many customers. And as it turns out, the CEO wasn't briefed, wasn't on board with making the decision to make that public statement. Now, it wasn't about values because they had the policy, it was in place, they were standing by it. It was a tactical question about do we say it, do we not say it? And it might have been the right thing to do, but you would certainly want everybody on board. So find that core and make sure you're all in the boat, ready to link arms and stand up for it. A really critical litmus test here is the notion of finding that intersection of what's an issue that matters, what's an issue that resonates with whoever it is that you're addressing, but that also overlaps with what is true, unique, special, credible, authentic about your brand. And when those two things overlap, that's quite powerful, that's sustainable, that's meaningful. But the danger comes when you stray outside of that. And we have one most unfortunate instance of that happening in the case of Pepsi and the dreaded Kendall Jenner ad, right, where there was just a complete mismatch in what was the issue, you know, social strife, conflict, battles in the streets, and this brand playing some catalyzing, transformational role in that, as told through a B-list celebrity with all the requisite, you know, racially diverse cello player in the middle of Broadway. So it smacked of all of the downsides of everything I just talked about and gave rise to what I think is the most devastating tweet in history, which was Martin Luther King's daughter saying, "If only Daddy would have known about the power of Pepsi." Wow, that would haunt my dreams forever. So it's so important to, as you're finding that issue, making sure it's genuine, it's true, it's a part of who you are. Because at the end of the day, you know, the question that you're answering is the question Sean Connery so compellingly asked in The Untouchables, what are you prepared to do, right? There's no easy way to either deal with this or not deal with this. So you have to be fully prepared, everyone, to stand up for or sit down for whatever it is and deal with what might come. So the next phase is understanding your constituents. And, you know, this is a room full of people who live and breathe insights and personas and data, right? So, duh. But this is really about understanding in a different way than we're used to. And it's about getting into their brains and their hearts and their tummies beyond just the usual segmentations and personas. Sally is a soccer mom who drives a minivan and prefers chocolate in the afternoon. Yes, critical. But now we're talking about really understanding and what are her core values, right? What are the issues that are motivating and energizing and catalyzing to her? And probably, you know, how does she vote? Again, not so that you can then reverse engineer and slavishly and inauthentically craft your strategy to match that person's wishes, because another trend going on is we're increasingly seeing the power of being who you are and naturally attracting the people who are resonating with that, as opposed to trying to reverse engineer and fit in a ways that are sort of polished and antiseptic. But you look at Trump himself, you look at Kim Kardashian, right? Sort of two ironically similar examples of brands that were built through just sort of, I am what I am, right? Some people will absolutely loathe me. Some people will love me because I am just saying this is who I am and I'm kind of bearing all, warts and all, and I'm not polished, I'm not using a teleprompter, taking photos of me, getting my face sort of all made up. So it's not about understanding your constituents so that you can kind of cynically match what they're looking for, but that you can really understand, if this is who I am, who am I going to resonate with, and what choices does that set up? Then there's this kind of math exercise that you can literally do with consumer research, or you can do conceptually, but it's about saying, for a given issue that we care about and I'm taking a stand on, how will it affect my different constituents? And there's been some really fascinating research at the University of South Florida that looks at what are the bumps and the nicks that a brand would get from taking a position. So there are people who would say, yes, I agree with your position on whatever, same-sex marriage, and I will therefore, you know, there's an 18% favorability lift, intent to purchase lift for people who agree with that position. And then on the other side, the people who disagree with your position will be 12% less inclined. And what's interesting is the magnitude of those changes. Is it 30% or 6%? As well as the relativity. Is it net-net more positive or more negative? Changes by issue and by segment. There's no generic sort of rule of thumb for that. So it's about really understanding who am I, what do I care for, who are my constituents, and how do they feel about these issues, and you know, how does that net out? Again, not for the sake of necessarily making a dollars and cents choice, but just understanding the implications of what are you looking at. And there's one more kind of critical factor in this balance, and that is, what do I just believe is important, either strategically long-term for the business, you know, maybe I'll take a hurt now, but in 3 years I'll be glad I did it, or I just think it's the right thing, right? This is just good for society, this is important, I believe this is right, and therefore I understand, you know, it will have an impact one way or another on this math. And you really need to just sort of take that all into account. And again, that's part and parcel of this aligning around the issue and your perspective and your point of view as an organization. A critical issue that organizations often overlook is who are all their constituents? And naturally, we all think customers, right? And of course, most of us also think associates. But often you see organizations getting surprised that they have constituents that they hadn't really thought of in that way. And I think Under Armour is an interesting example. When early on, the CEO, founder, Kevin Plank, expressed support for some of Trump's policies and suddenly discovered there was this constituency called the sponsored athletes, who, by the way, had a voice and kind of as a group rose up and said, whoa, 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 not so fast. You know, thank you for those big fat checks you write me, but I don't agree with what you're saying from a political issue perspective, right? So clearly there had not been a thought process that said, you know, who are the various groups that will have a point of view on what we do and what we say, and how do we think about them, and how do we anticipate what their feelings and issues will be? Next step, develop scenarios. So this is about taking the time in advance to think through what could happen, what could go wrong, what could trigger a response, and thinking broadly because it can come from any number of sources. It could be something from a marketing perspective that we do. You know, for example, a Kendall Jenner ad that suddenly generates a storm. It could be something that happens from a customer perspective. Could be something that happens in the political world, a la Budweiser, right? It's not that they sort of took an action per se, it's that something happened over here in the political arena that shed new light on what they were already doing in their marketing arena. There are acts of God, you know? A storm takes out a facility, suddenly service goes down to a part of town that's disproportionately one socioeconomic group, and suddenly you're answering, why don't you care about this group of people, right? Who knows what it could be? Every business has different dynamics, different issues that could crop up in this way, and it's critical to get ahead of that and, you know, with a reasonably organized thought process, understand what are those scenarios, how would it play out, and how do you see them coming, if at all possible. Another really important part of this thought process is as you're looking at how is this starting to add up to a set of brand values and a point of view and a belief about the world, how does that match up to brand reality, right? How much have we been walking the walk over time? And, you know, as I mentioned earlier, the risk of bandwagon hopping is that if what you have been doing, if your actions, if your words over time don't match the flag that you're now waving, that can be a very dangerous thing. So you've got to do a really honest kind of audit of yourself and look for what are the vulnerabilities. And the fact that, you know, there may be a wart somewhere in the world or in your past with respect to that issue doesn't mean don't do it, but it means understand it, don't hide from it, and be ready to deal with it. And a really important part of that, too, is enrolling your associates and keeping you honest, right? Give everyone a little sort of virtual red buzzer that they can hit when they see the organization diverting from whatever values that was. Because in an organization of any size, no one person can have sort of the view of all that's going on. And it's far too easy for some office somewhere in the world to create an issue that swamps the brand overall. And, you know, we had an instance of that with Audi and the Super Bowl ad that you may remember.
What do I tell my daughter? Do I tell her that her grandpa's worth more than her grandma? That her dad is worth more than her mom? Do I tell her that despite her education, her drive, her skills, her intelligence, she will automatically be valued as less than every man she ever meets? Or maybe I'll be able to tell her something different.
So once again, beautiful film, stirring story, great issue. The only problem is Audi doesn't have many women in the boardroom or the executive suite. And that's a little awkward when you're out there saying, equal pay, everybody, right? So now they've got this dilemma. They've been outed as not walking the walk. So do they continue to beat this drum and continue to live with that gap between what they say and what they do? And, you know, we all know how long it takes to actually take corrective action in terms of the diversity of your associate base, particularly in the executive suite. Or do they drop it and look even so much more like a cynical bandwagon hopper? So really, really do that audit and make sure you know what you're in for. Then it's about being proactively transparent. Now, we all know how hard it is to communicate with the world and have consumers remember and believe what it is you do. You know, we're a floor wax that leaves it nice and shiny, right? That's tough enough. But to get consumers to understand, believe, and remember what you stand for from a values perspective, that's really tough. And it doesn't just happen, and it doesn't happen because you have a values tab deep in your website. But you've got to be continually forward-leaning with it. You've got to think like marketers, think reach and frequency. You need more than just yourself to do it. So it's about looking at who are your loyalists, who are your talking heads, who's your Kellyanne Conway, who can go out to the world and speak up for you, either proactively or when times get tough. And they can say, whoa, whoa, I understand. There was that, you know, thing at the airport with the surge pricing, but I know these guys, and they didn't have anything bad in their hearts. You need people to be able to speak up for you like that. So they need to be armed with talking points. You need to be in a two-way dialogue with them so they're in a position to rise up and defend you. I mentioned earlier on the cute little Finch sewing studio in cute little Lynchburg, Virginia. So they're a poster child for this. So this is a little shop that has knitting supplies and sewing supplies. And a few days before the Women's March in Washington, they had a little Facebook post that said, oh, by the way, we've got plenty of pink yarn in case you're knitting anything for an event that might be coming up. Period, right? Pretty low-key, you know, in the realm of rabble-rousing, flaming, frothing-at-the-mouth political statements. Pretty innocuous. But it was more than enough to get them on a list of anti-Trump businesses that then caused a boycott and drove all kinds of news and press and cameras showing up. And an interesting thing happened. Their constituents rose up and said, we know these people, right? They've been here for years. We know their values. We know they're inclusive. We know they don't sort of have a position about you're good, you're bad, I'm right, you're evil. So get over it. And this incredible groundswell of positivity really ended up being a positive for the business when all was said and done. And even people like Heather saying, I don't knit, but you know what, I'll come on by because, you know, you guys are pretty awesome. So it shows the power of being clear and forward and consistent with who you are and what you stand for. And as I mentioned, it takes time, it takes frequency. And this is an example of Lyft. A few months ago, took out a full-page ad in the Sunday New York Times, among many other placements, in which they were talking about a community program, rounding up and giving back, basically showing, you know, their true colors, so to speak, and their values, reflecting this need to be explicit, be forward, and think of it as a marketing strategy. Now, it is a tough world out there, and there's no free lunch. That didn't stop Mashable from saying, sorry, Lyft, being less awful than Uber doesn't make you woke. So it's a tough world. Brave execution. So having done all this, now you have to kind of get ready for the storm. You have to presume it's going to happen. And again, everybody has the crisis binder on their shelf somewhere. And chances are there's a few blanks in there, and there's probably a few names of people who have moved on. And if you had to put chapter 3 into practice, it might be a little bit rusty. You've got to really kind of get that tight, make it current, go through fire drills, understand who says what to whom, who's empowered to speak, what are the talking points, because you can't be formulating that stuff on the fly. And then you've got to continuously monitor. As I said, these things can spread like wildfire, but you've got to be looking for those little sparks, because addressing them quickly and honestly can help kind of put it out quickly. We've seen plenty of examples recently of the semi-quasi-pseudo-apology that only fanned the flames further versus just the straight-up, okay, let's take this thing on and deal with it quickly, makes all the difference in the world. And when things really do hit the fan, right, then it's about responding in the same venue. If it blows up on Twitter, don't do a press release to answer it, because you're talking in a different forest and the tree fell over there and nobody's going to hear you. And in this digital world now, you've got less than 24 hours to respond, right? So that's why you don't have time to circle the wagons, drag the CEO off the golf course, sit down, figure out what are we going to say, who's going to say it, what was the thing about the guy in France who did the thing or didn't do the thing. You don't have time for that, right? You have to have worked that all out in advance. It has to be a playbook. You have to have the information down, because you just, there's no such thing as time to react. And, you know, I spoke to a number of CMOs in the course of sort of developing these thoughts. Interestingly, not a single one of them wanted to be on the record, but many of them were brands that we've seen in the hot seat. And one said, you know, we got hit by something, we got together, we developed a really awesome response that should have put it all out, but it was 2 days later and the world moved on, right? We were a whole news cycle too late. So it had already gelled and solidified and we were done. And another really critical rule is don't change your position, right? Another CMO said, you know what, we got sort of a backlash. We said, wow, that's more than we expected. We probably, you know, weren't ready for this. So you're right, we'll pivot, change our minds. Here's our new perspective. Aren't you all happy? And the answer was, everybody was pissed off now, right? Because the people they originally offended were still offended. And the people who originally agreed with them considered them traitors and turncoats and spineless weasels. So everybody was mad. So that's why going way back to the beginning, going through a thoughtful process of what do you stand for or not stand for, and making sure everybody is aligned is so critical, because when you're in this situation and when temperatures are high and the press is calling and consumers are storming the castle, that's not the time to be debating fundamental issues like, was this right or was this not right? So we've talked a lot about kind of the risks and the downsides and the issues. I want to take a minute and really focus on some learning from success. So this is the Heineken Worlds Apart piece. How many people are familiar with that? Okay, just a few. I won't run the whole thing because it's longish, but I'll run some of it so you get a flavor of it. And I'd encourage you to go look at it in your own time because it's really quite interesting. Let's take a look.
I would describe my political views as the new right.
I'd say that I'm left.
Feminism today is man-hating.
I would describe myself as a feminist, 100%.
I don't believe that climate change exists.
We're not taking enough action on climate change.
I think it's about time these people got off the high horse and started looking for credible problems that actually exist.
It's absolutely critical that trans people have their own voice.
That's not right. You can't, you know, you're a man, be a man, or you're a female, be a female.
Women do need to remember that we need you to have our children.
Could I be friends with someone that says a woman's place in the home?
Right, okay, well, I'm an expert at flat packs. If you have any trouble, just watch me.
So basically what they do is these pairs of absolutely diametrically opposed people couldn't be more far apart. Unbeknownst to each other, they're thrown together to do a task. And they have instructions, and they have to take these construction bits and do a whole project. And as the project evolves, it turns out they've constructed kind of a bar, like in the, you know, corner pub. And then they stand there as a pair and watch the videos of each other speaking, and they realize, wow, this person who's been my partner in building this thing, you know, believes there's no such thing as climate change. Or I thought most remarkably, the guy who is saying, you know, man is man, woman is woman, the woman in that pair was a trans woman. What a remark. And by the way, the man had been saying, wow, you're in the army. I have such respect for you. That's so amazing. Wow, I honor your service. And then suddenly they have this experience of saying, oh my gosh, you know, you're so different from me. And then the last question that they're posed is, you can either go your separate ways or you can sit at this bar you've built and share a beer and a chat. And of course, you know, they all shared a beer and a chat. And what followed in the dialogue was just so remarkable. And they had, you know, a positive sharing of points of view. And, you know, some of them ended with, hey, you know what? I still think you're wrong, but I like you, right? And in others, there was a little bit more enlightenment and self-awareness and very, very powerful stuff. So in many ways, it was the polar opposite of the dreaded Kendall Jenner exercise. So, you know, what were the things that made this so incredibly effective? One is that it was a focused issue. They didn't say, oh my gosh, the world is sort of a big fat mess, strife, problems, world hunger, cats and dogs living together, right? They took a focused issue of, we don't talk, right? If we have different points of view, we just don't engage. And they then had an appropriate aspiration. It was not, we're going to solve all of this. We're going to make it all better. The aspiration was sit down and have a chat, right? Step one solution to the problem we articulated is talk to each other in a positive, non-combative way. There was also an absolutely credible role for the brand, right? They didn't say, Heineken will change the world and solve world hunger and we will live together in peace and harmony. No, they said, what do you do with a beer? You sit down and you have a chat. Gather around, spend some time, get to know each other, right? So the role of the brand was perfectly appropriate, perfectly credible. It was also an authentic story, right? These were not only real people, but real people that you could see, you know, weren't polished. They didn't necessarily, they had flaws. They had points of view you might think are crazy or just plain wrong. But there was nothing polished and phony and posed and poised about it, again, as there was in the Pepsi ad with the B-list celebrity and the racially diverse cello player in the street, right? And then, so importantly, this represented a sustained commitment on the part of Heineken. They were sponsoring a study with the university on the science of common ground. They built a bespoke chatbot with Facebook that will bring together people with divergent points of view. And they're part of a project called the Human Library, which uses conversation as a way to break down stereotypes. Right? So this is something they are clearly in it for the long haul. They're putting their money where their mouth is. This will be a sustaining drumbeat of a set of values and an issue that they care about. Again, so different than some of the examples we talked about before, which felt a little bit like insincere, opportunistic hopping. So I think this is a great poster child for how to wade into difficult territory and do it in a way that, by the way, doesn't by definition offend one part of the world or another. So it's not necessarily that having a point of view and standing for something means you absolutely by definition offend half the world. But if you do these things and focus on an issue and do it in an incredible, authentic way, right, you can stand for something good and not necessarily alienate half your customer base. So with that, I will close with, you know, there is real opportunity in all this sort of challenge and complexity, and that is that if you do what we're talking about, you'll be clarifying your place and your role in the world. You'll be putting your values on display in a more meaningful and transparent way than you might have otherwise. And by doing that, you'll be more authentic, more genuine, more relatable, and in the course of doing that, build more powerful and enduring relationships with your customers than ever before. So with that, I will close and say thank you, and take any questions that you might have.